Good morning, church. It's such a privilege and a pleasure to be with you this morning. Last week was a sobering reminder to me that we're not always guaranteed a new day. We're not always guaranteed a new week. We're not always guaranteed a new anything. And so I want to encourage you this morning, right at the beginning, that today is the day that we have been given. Today. We have been given today. Scripture says today is the day of salvation. And so, right now, I want you to take a moment. I want you to take a moment. I want you to look ahead of you. You can see this young balding man. Look to your left. Look to your right. Look behind you. And I want you to notice, God has given you a spiritual family. God has given you a home. God has placed you here, right now, for this moment. And God does nothing by accident. God has given you a new day in which to worship Him, to praise Him, to obey Him. And most importantly, God has given us an opportunity today to love others. This is where we put the gospel into practice. And do we not sing and do we not say, today is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And so that is, I just want to remind you of that and encourage you with that today is your day. Today is a new day. As I was spending time this last week, it was a lot of time in prayer and thought as I was limited to a hospital bed. I was immobile, not allowed to do anything, not allowed to work, not allowed. And it was a really good time for me to think, to pray, to spend time with God. And as I was talking with God and meditating in His Word, He's been sharing a lot with me about plans. And this morning I want to share with you what the Holy Spirit shared with me, and it's busy having a large impact in my life. And so the title of this morning's message is Good Plans. Good Plans. And some of you may be quickly jumping to Romans, but please don't. Turn with me to the book of Judges. Judges 11. And I will explain myself when we get to it. But before we read the Word of God, let us open up in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I just want to say thank you. Thank you that you love me so much that you sent Jesus to die for me. But Lord, I also thank you for the responsibility of this new day. I pray that we will begin to look at our new days as responsibilities. Responsibility to honor you, to love you, to worship you. But Lord, as we now approach your word, I ask you, Holy Spirit, to carry me. Lord, I know how unremarkable my mind is. But Lord, may it be so that your mind may be seen and visible, that your word may be seen and visible, that your message may be made visible to our hearts. And so as we approach your word, Lord, Holy Spirit, I ask you to speak. Speak clearly and speak loudly and convict us of your word right now. I ask this in the powerful name of my Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We are in the book of Judges, chapter 11, and we're going to read the whole chapter. And I want to see if you are familiar with this great man of faith. Let us read the word of God together. Judges 11, verse 1. Now Jephthah, the Gileadite, was a mighty warrior. But he was the son of a prostitute. Gilead was the father of Jephthah. And Gilead's wife also bore him sons. And when his wife's sons grew up, they drove Jephthah out and said to him, "You shall not have an inheritance in our father's house, for you are the son of another woman." Then Jephthah fled from his brothers and lived in the land of Tob. And worthless fellows collected around Jephthah and went out with him. After a time, the Ammonites made war against Israel. And when the Ammonites made war against Israel, the elders of Gilead went to bring Jephthah from the land of Tob. And they said to Jephthah, "Come and be our leader that we may fight against the Ammonites." But Jephthah said to the elders of Gilead, "Did you not hate me and drive me out of my father's house? Why have you come to me now when you are in distress?" And the elders of Gilead said to Jephthah, "But that is why we have turned to you now, that you may go with us and fight against the Ammonites and be our head over all the inhabitants of Gilead." Jephthah said to the elders of Gilead, "If you bring me home again to fight against the Ammonites, and the Lord gives them over to me, I will be your head." And the elders of Gilead said to Jephthah, "The Lord will be witness between us if we do not do as you say." So Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and leader over them. And Jephthah spoke all his words before the Lord at Mizpah. Then Jephthah sent messengers to the king of the Ammonites and said, "What do you have against me that you have come to me and fight against my land?" And the king of the Ammonites answered the messengers of Jephthah, "Because Israel, on coming up from Egypt, took away my land from the Arnon to Jabbok and to the Jordan, and therefore restore it peacefully." Jephthah again sent messengers to the king of the Ammonites and said to him, "Thus says Jephthah, Israel did not take away the land of Moab or the land of the Ammonites. But when they came up from Egypt, Israel went through the wilderness to the Red Sea and came to Kadesh. Israel then sent messengers to the king of Edom, saying, 'Please let us pass through your land.' But the king of Edom would not listen. And they sent also to the king of Moab, but he would not consent. So Israel remained at Kadesh. Then they journeyed through the wilderness and went around the land of Edom and the land of Moab and arrived on the east side of the land of Moab and camped on the other side of the Arnon. But they did not enter the territory of Moab, for the Arnon was the boundary of Moab. Israel then sent messengers to Sihon, the king of the Amorites, king of Heshbon, and Israel said to him, 'Please let us pass through your land to our own country.' But Sihon did not trust Israel to pass through his territory, so Sihon gathered all his people together and encamped at Jahaz and fought with Israel. And the Lord, the God of Israel, gave Sihon and all his people into the hand of Israel, and they defeated them. So Israel took possession of all the land of the Amorites who inhabited that country. And they took possession of all the territory of the Amorites from the Arnon to the Jabbok and from the wilderness to the Jordan. So then the Lord, the God of Israel, dispossessed the Amorites from before his people Israel. And are you to take possession of them?" Verse 24 is interesting. Jephthah says to this king of the Ammonites, "Will you not possess what Chemosh, your God, gives you to possess? And all that the Lord our God has dispossessed before us, we will possess. Now, are you any better than Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab? Did he ever contend against Israel, or did he ever go to war with them? While Israel lived in Heshbon and its villages, and in Aroer and its villages, and in all the cities that are on the banks of the Arnon, 300 years. Why did you not deliver them within that time? If you really wanted all this land, why didn't you do it 300 years before? I therefore have not sinned against you, and you do me wrong by making war on me. The Lord, the judge, decide this day between the people of Israel and the people of Ammon." But the king of the Ammonites did not listen to the words of Jephthah that he sent him. And a very beautiful phrase in verse 29, then the Spirit of the Lord was upon Jephthah, and he passed through Gilead and Manasseh and passed on to Mizpah of Gilead. And from Mizpah of Gilead, he passed on to the Ammonites. And now we see a very interesting shift in the text. And Jephthah made a vow to the Lord and said, if you will give me the Ammonites into my hand, then whatever comes out from the doors of my house to meet me when I return in peace from the Ammonites shall be the Lord's, and I will offer it up for a burnt offering. So Jephthah crossed over to the Ammonites to fight against them, and the Lord gave them into his hand. And he struck them from Aroer to the neighborhood of Minnith, 20 cities, and as far as Abel Keramim, with a great blow. So the Ammonites were subdued before the people of Israel. Verse 34, then Jephthah came to his home in Mizpah, and behold, his daughter came out to meet him with tambourines and with dances. She was his only child. Besides her, he had neither son nor daughter. And as soon as he saw her, he tore his clothes and said, alas, my daughter, you have brought me very low. And you have become the cause of great trouble to me, for I have opened my mouth to the Lord, and I cannot take back my vow. And she said to him, my father, you have opened your mouth to the Lord. Do to me according to what has gone out of your mouth, now that the Lord has avenged you on your enemies, on the Ammonites. So she said to her father, let this thing be done for me. Just leave me alone for 2 months, that I may go up and down on the mountains and weep for my virginity, I and my companions. So he said, go. And then he sent her away for 2 months, and she departed, she and her companions, and wept for her virginity on the mountains. And at the end of 2 months, she returned to her father, who did with her according to his vow that he had made. She had never known a man, and it became a custom in Israel that the daughters of Israel went year by year to lament the daughter of Jephthah, the Gileadite, 4 days in the year. May God bless the reading of his word. And I pray that the reading of God's word will always excite your hearts. But you may be wondering this morning, what does this have to do with good plans? This does not seem like a good plan. And I promise you, I will explain myself. But first, let us be good Baptists and get the context of our story. How familiar are you with Jephthah? How familiar are you? If I had to ask you to mention some of the great heroes of faith in Hebrews chapter 11, I'm sure many of you would say Abraham, David. And in the same sentence David is mentioned, so is Jephthah. Jephthah, this man is mentioned in the great hall of faith in Hebrews chapter 11. And Hebrews 11 verse 38 tells us that the world is not worthy of men like this. After reading his story, it's hard to imagine what sort of faith is being displayed here. And so I want us to consider the story of Jephthah first in its context, and then after that I'm going to explain to you where we get to learn the lesson regarding good plans. What is the context of the book of Judges? Let us begin there. The book of Judges is a beautiful story about the early history of Israel. This is before the time of kings. This is before they have a leader. And what we see in the book of Judges, time and time again, is a cycle of people who sin. What we see time and time again is the Israelites, they turn away from God, they get oppressed by various nations, and then they cry out to God. God raises up the leader, they come back to God, and they repeat the cycle. They sin again, they turn away from God, and they are oppressed again. back to chapter 10, verse 6 of Judges, we can see that pattern. We can see the context. Chapter 10, verse 6, it tells us that the people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. And they served the Baals and the Ashereth, the gods of Syria, the gods of Sidon, and the gods of Moab, the gods of the Ammonites, and the gods of the Philistines. They forsook the Lord and did not serve him. And we see this pattern repeated if you read through the book of Judges. The Israelites keep doing this. They keep doing evil again. The word again is important. And so in the context of Judges, what we see, the theme of the book, the theme is that God raises up oppression when his people turn away from him. Verse 7 of chapter 10 shows us this. But the judges, where the title of the book comes from, the judges are the leaders God raises up to deliver them from their oppression. And so the message of the book is clear. People need God to lead their lives. That is sort of the theme, if you would, of the book of Judges, that people need God to lead them. They need a leader, and that leader is God. But if we read from chapter 10, verse 6, all the way to the end of chapter 10, that serves as the immediate context for chapter 11. And to just make it quite simple for you, the Israelites did evil, and now the Ammonites are oppressing them. And what's fascinating is, if you look at the history, the Ammonites are the descendants of Lot. Do you remember Lot, Abraham's nephew? And if you remember in Genesis, what we read is the servants of Lot were fighting with the servants of Abraham about land. And we see that repeated again in our story, don't we? This repetitive nature. And so because Israel had forsaken their God, the Ammonites come and cause trouble. And so our text begins with the Ammonite army posing a massive and a real threat to the people of Israel. And in steps our hero, Jephthah. And if we look at our first three verses of chapter 11, we are introduced to this mighty man of faith. Verse 1 to 3 give us some backstory to Jephthah. You see, Jephthah was a talented man. A mighty warrior. But no matter how talented he was still rejected. He was a rejected man. Talented, but a reject nonetheless. You see, Jephthah was driven away from the land of Israel. He was thrown out of the community of God's people. He was removed from a hope for a future. Notice the reason he was driven away was because of the inheritance. He was removed from a hope for a future. You see, his brothers made sure that the inheritance of his father, that he would come nowhere near it, simply because he was disqualified. If you read Deuteronomy chapter 23, it tells us that the children of an illegitimate union are not allowed to enter the assembly of the Lord up to 10 generations. And so what we see in our context is these brothers took the law and they used it to drive him away. It wasn't when he was a child he was driven away. Notice it's when the sons of Gilead's wife were grown that he was chased away. Chased away from the family, the life, the friends that he knew. And what we notice in verse 3 is that it says only worthless fellows collected around Jephthah, almost pointing to this emphasis that everything that had value was stripped away from Jephthah. The inheritance was taken away. Friends of value were taken away. He was placed in a condition and in a situation that was worthless, hopeless. What future is there for a man like this? And then the Ammonites make war with Israel, and then we notice the elders of Gilead come to Jephthah. And what's fascinating is Jephthah's father's name was Gilead. And so it's a reasonable assumption to assume that some of his very brothers might have been elders of the area of Gilead. And so whether there are some of his brothers present or not, the elders would have been aware, perhaps even involved, in the driving away of Jephthah. We see that in Jephthah's response to him. And so now, in a time where they need to win a battle, in the time where there is a war, the elders look for a mighty warrior. And so they come to Jephthah in their time of need. And I want to highlight to you here, do you see the mirror image being played out here? Are these elders of Gilead, are they treating Jephthah the same way the Israelites are treating God? Yes, we see this mirror image in Judges. You see, the Israelites discarded God to worship other idols in a very similar way that the brothers discarded Jephthah. They return to God only because they are in trouble with the Ammonites, and in a very similar way, they turn to Jephthah only because there is a war on their hands. But do you see how the Israelites are missing the point still? They are turning to Jephthah to deliver them instead of God to deliver them. The theme of Judges screams at us here, saying salvation is found in God alone, never in man. And we see this played out. They turn to Jephthah and they say, Jephthah, save us. The story continues and we see that Jephthah makes a deal with the elders. He says he'll be their the leader of the people if he handles the Ammonite problem. And then from verse 12 all the way to 33, we sort of see many things. We see how well Jephthah knows the Bible of his time. He knows the history of his people. He knows the condition and the state of affairs of his people. He knows the word of God of his day very well. But you also notice that Jephthah wasn't bloodthirsty. Although a mighty warrior, he didn't fight with the Ammonites at the first chance he got. He gave them an opportunity for peace. That's what all those long verses we read were all about. He's saying, I've done you no wrong. This is a land God has given me. Leave us alone. And we see the culmination in verse 28, where the king of the Ammonites did not listen to Jephthah, and so they fought. So it's important, for the sake of context, to realize Jephthah was not a bloodthirsty man. You see, and no one fights, and no one who ever fights against the Spirit of the Lord wins. Do you see that in the text as well? You see the moment in verse 29 when it says the Spirit of the Lord was upon Jephthah. At that moment, victory was assured. Victory was assured because the Spirit was upon Jephthah. But then verse 30 to 31 poses us a problem. Verses 30 to 31 is a confusion. It is in this moment we see Jephthah making a vow, a promise of dedication to God. And verses 34 to 40 tell us he was faithful in that vow. Is this a moment of human sacrifice? Is this a vow made in haste without thought? How is the same man who makes a vow like this included in Hebrews 11? It's helpful here to notice the context of the vow. He makes this vow straight after being filled with the Holy Spirit. That's important. I hope you see that. 29, the Spirit of the Lord was upon him, and then 30, he makes this vow. And so the context of the moving of the Holy Spirit is very important. And so to assume that this is a vow made in haste without thought is to neglect the passage and the movement of the Spirit here. This is not a vow that's made on a whim. It would appear to me that the Holy Spirit has a role in at least instigating a vow, a commitment. Second, I want you to note that the object of the offering is not a thing but a person. If you look at the text when he makes this vow, he says, whatever comes out of the doors of my house, what Jephthah has in mind is a person. That would be the only thing that would come out of a house, is a person. And that causes us some discomfort, I'm sure, because he ends it with a burnt offering. Jephthah clearly has a person in mind, since he's talking about someone who would come out his house. And I think what makes it so uncomfortable is not so much the vow, but the fulfillment of the vow. When we read that, yes, he made this promise, but he followed through with it. Verse 39 of our text tells us he did to her according to his vow. Is this a moment of human sacrifice? If we read the text literally, then yes. And that causes many, many issues. And so I want to alleviate your suffering right now, and I want to remind you, human sacrifice was strongly forbidden in the law of Moses. We saw from verses 12 to 28, he knew the law extremely well. And if he did not know the law well, the Holy Spirit surely does. And so we cannot read the words burnt offering here as literally as that, because this would cause conflict with the role of the Holy Spirit in his life. God never lies, God never contradicts himself. And so I want to show you in Scripture how this is not human sacrifice, but this is dedication. And this is not a foreign concept in the Old Testament. Do you recall Hannah, the great Hannah, the one who prayed for a son and got Samuel, one of the greatest prophets of all? And what happened when Samuel came? Samuel was given to the temple. As soon as she got her firstborn, she gave the offering back to God. And this language of using priestly language in a more figurative sense is also used by the great Apostle Paul. Great Apostle Paul, how does he describe his life in 2 Timothy? He says, I am like a drink offering poured out. And so what's fascinating about the burnt offering, if we look at its symbolism and its role in the sacrificial system of the Israelites, is the burnt offering was all about complete dedication. It's an offering that is completely consumed so that nothing is left for the priests, everything that belongs to God. And so the vow that Jephthah makes here is saying, the first person out my doors will be given to the service of God completely. And you'll notice this makes a lot of sense, because if you look at the response of the daughter in the text, she's not weeping for her life, is she? She's weeping that she will never marry. She will not fulfill her role in society. She will now be the servant of the tabernacle of the temple. You see, the context here, what we also notice is, do you remember King Saul? King Saul made this rash vow where he said, anyone who eats during this battle, we will execute. Lo and behold, his son, Jonathan, has a taste of honey, wins the battle. When King Saul finds out, he says, okay, I've got to kill you, Jonathan. And it wasn't Saul who got him out of that predicament, it was the people. The people rallied around Jonathan and said, Saul, how can you execute a man who won such a battle? And if the history throughout the scriptures is that God never accepts human sacrifice, why would we be so quick to assume he does here? It's important. The only human sacrifice God has ever accepted is the only human sacrifice that is worthy and capable of change, and that is Jesus Christ on a cross. And so it's important in the context here that we realize this is not a case of human sacrifice. Remember, human sacrifice was a very common practice in the pagan nations of the time. Throughout the Old Testament, we see how God is angry at the surrounding nations for offering children as sacrifices. Why would that same God be okay with it here? So remember, when we read scripture, to use all of scripture. And so what we see here is that Jephthah makes this solemn vow that he will dedicate completely a person of his house. And when I get to the good laws, I'll show you some more about it. But he does not violate the law of Moses, the law of God revealed to Moses here. He gives a person completely devoted to God. And so in our text, I hope you can see that Jephthah is faithful in his vow as well as being faithful to God. And I find it a beautiful picture how his daughter was faithful in it all as well. I mean, what an amazing response of the daughter to say to her father, "Do to me as you have promised to God." That takes faith. It's a beautiful, beautiful moment. So the question is, how does any of this relate to good plans? This doesn't seem to be a good plan. Remember, the context of this time period is Israel is looking for a leader, a king. Later in Samuel, we see the culmination of that moment where Israel say, "Samuel, give us a king." And God tells Samuel, "They have not rejected you this day, they have rejected me." And so throughout this time in Judges, this is the anticipation of the people. They are looking for a leader, they are looking for a king, and they cannot see that it's meant to be God. They keep going from one leader to the next, and you'll see in the context throughout the book, each leader tries to set themselves up as the future king. And so right now, let us put ourselves in Jephthah's shoes for a moment. Let us pretend we are Jephthah. Imagine that here you are. You've been thrown out of society. You are an illegitimate child. You don't count. You cannot enter the assembly of God. And on top of all of this, they drove you out as an adult. You lost all the friends you had growing up, the family you knew. They all betrayed you. They all cast you out. And most likely, as you were cast out, that's where your skills in battle developed and grew. You had to fight for yourself, fight for survival. And now you have this great opportunity. These people have come back to you with the tail between their legs. And you have this opportunity to be a king, to be a chief, to be a captain, to be a leader. They are offering you to be the governmental head of the people, to make the decisions. It's really a story of zero to hero. And so you make this vow with God. And you're probably thinking along the lines of this, because in this culture, in this time, you often find they make sacrifices to establish the foundation of something. When a new era or new government form came into power, there was always sacrifices. You see that with the kings. They sacrifice many, many things to say, "We dedicate this reign to God." And so this drives the motive behind the vow, and he's probably thinking along the lines of, "Lord, I will dedicate to you my best servant if you would give me victory in this battle so that my legacy, my inheritance that was taken from me may be secured for my children." Remember, what's fascinating is Inheritance could also be given to daughters. We see in the law there was this incident in Gilead, of all places, where the man has seven daughters, not a single son, and they ask, what shall happen with the inheritance? And Moses makes the decree, yes, you can give it to your daughters, provided they marry within their same tribe. Which is fascinating, because here we see the inheritance playing a major role again. He makes the sacrifice, makes this vow, saying, I'll give you my best servant if you would secure my inheritance as the governmental head of this people. My descendants will not be outcast as I once was. And you see, what we actually see playing out in the scripture and in the text here is that Jephthah has a good plan to secure his future, the future of his child. It's not a bad plan. It's worshiping God. It's giving God the glory. You see, Jephthah has this plan to secure his line, his heritage, through legitimate means of offering to God freely. And if you look at verse 34, it's very significant that he says only child. We see this beautiful picture. The word only in Hebrew here, only child, is actually talking about begotten. Does that remind you of an only begotten child as well? Jesus, the only begotten. There's this beautiful imagery going on here. And the text here is highlighting again that it's about the legacy. That's why it's the only child, the significance. That's why it's about the virginity that's significant. That's why inheritance is significant in the text and in this chapter. Because this is not about a sacrifice. This is about Jephthah coming up with a really good plan to secure the future. And then when he gets home, he sees his plan fall apart. As he gets home, he sees everything he's planned, everything he's put together, as good as it was, fall apart because it's his daughter. It's his daughter, the one he's trying to secure the future for, that comes out to greet him. And this is why the text focuses on the weeping over her virginity. Because now she will never marry and she'll be fully dedicated to the Lord. And again, as I said earlier, it's amazing to see how both Jephthah and his daughter were faithful in this vow. It's a beautiful picture. But I believe this was a moment of great humbling for Jephthah. When he sees his daughter, he learned here very quickly, very painfully, that the best devised plans mean nothing in the comparison to the plans of God. You see, Jephthah received good from the Lord. But it wasn't the good he had planned. Remember, he was an outcast. And if you look at how our text ends, in chapter 12, we notice that Jephthah, 12 verse 7, it says, Jephthah judged Israel for 6 long years. It's still a good story. It's still a good future. Jephthah went from outcast to reject to leading a nation for 6 years. It's an amazing story. But it wasn't the story or the plan that Jephthah had. How often is this true of us? Romans 8 verse 28, one of our favorite verses, I'm sure. All things work together for the good of those who love God according to his purpose. But how often have we confused the good plans of God with good plans of our own? We often have a logic, a reasoning that says, but Lord, if you bless me in my ministry as a young pastor, the good I can do to thousands. That doesn't mean that's God's plan. It's a good plan. There's nothing sinful in it. It's preaching the gospel. But oftentimes, we confuse good plans with God's plans. We are assured in Scripture, and I want to encourage you with this, God's plans for us are good. We see this in the story of Jephthah. He went from absolutely outcast to leading. That's good. But how great the disappointment when we followed our own plan instead of the plan of God. And so this is the encouragement and the challenge I set before you from the text this morning. Assess whether the plan you have is from God or whether it's merely just another good plan. Let us not confuse our good plans with God's plans. Jephthah had a good plan to worship God and have an inheritance to give to his only daughter. And of all of this good, Jephthah, very much like the Israelite nation at the time, could not see that it is God and God alone who must sit on the throne. It wasn't Jephthah's place to create a legacy where Jesus was one day to sit on the throne. That's the context of Judges, isn't it? God is preparing the place, the seed of David to rule forever and ever, to sit on the throne everlasting. It was not Jephthah's place to build a legacy on what rightfully belongs to Jesus. And this is the question I have for you this morning. Are you perhaps living out your Christian faith like Jephthah, where you are the one coming up with the plans, the good plans, and are asking God to sign off on them? Lord, here's this awesome plan. Bless me and keep me through this financial scheme and that financial scheme. Are you perhaps coming up with a plan for your life that seems good to you and hoping that God will make it happen? Perhaps we should take a moment and allow God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, to simply have his way, whatever that may look like. I assure you again, the plans God has for you are good. He promises blessing and eternal life and life abundant to his people. But let us make sure we are not occupying the seat of his throne, that it remains God on the throne of our lives. Let us pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that we can learn from a great hero of faith like Jephthah, that you can restore even the most broken of situations from being completely outcast, from being completely written off. You restored him to his family. You gave him a good life. But Father, help us to learn the lesson to trust in your plans and not to come up with our own good plans. To find the faith to trust in you. But Father, also give us the courage to be faithful to the vows we make to you the way he was faithful. You blessed him for it. Help us to follow your plan with faith and courage. We ask this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Can we have a song and then I'll close with a benediction? So I end with this benediction, which is my prayer over you as God's people, from Psalm 86. Lord, teach us your ways, O Lord, that we may walk in your truth. Unite our hearts to fear your name. We give thanks to you, O Lord our God, with our whole heart, and we will glorify your name forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us for service. I pray that you are blessed in the week that lies ahead. Please join us.